Responsibility in Pennsylvania and Climate Realty Project Leader. So I'll turn it over to you. I'll turn it over to you now.
Very good. Okay. You can hear me, is that right?
Yes, we can hear you.
And I will assume that you can see my slides.
Yes, we can.
So we'll get going. First of all, I want to thank you all for allowing me to talk to you virtually. I know these are unprecedented times, and I do appreciate this opportunity to speak. I was in Jefferson Hills several years ago talking about this, about fracking in your area. There was a lot of concern at the time that Jefferson Hills is undermined from old coal mines, and there was a lot of concern from the community at the time, and I imagine there's a lot of concern now. So let me give you the health implications of having fracking near where you are, where you're living, where your kids go to school, where they're playing. I think Allie probably gave you a great presentation on the technical aspects, the technology, and how it works. Unfortunately, I couldn't hear, so I apologize for that. But fortunately, she shared her slides with me, so I was able to follow along with the slides. So look, before we get started, I just want to tell you and remind you that we do have a constitutional right as citizens of the state of Pennsylvania, a right to clean air, pure water, and to the preservation of the natural, scenic, historic, and aesthetic values of the environment. And that right is not just for all of us here in this room today. It's about our children and our grandchildren and for generations yet to come. So I wanted to start with that. And then the other thing I want to review with you is the 2020 grand jury report that the grand jury issued a scathing report about the harms to health, property, and livelihoods of Pennsylvanians living and working near a fracked gas operation. In addition to proving criminal activity within the industry, the grand jury uncovered negligence, incompetence, and complicity by the Department of Environmental Protection and the Department of Health. Two government agencies in charge of regulating an industry that has caused so much damage to public health. Time and again in its report, the grand jury kept returning to the fact that fracking was injuring children the most. Grand jury ended up with 8 recommendations for state regulators and lawmakers to try to fix the problems they found and so clearly documented. But so far, none of those recommendations has made its way into any new legislation. So the negligence and the incompetence and the complicity in our state capitol continues. I also want to remind you of why fracking has expanded so rapidly here in southwestern Pennsylvania, because the real prize of the Marcellus Shale is not methane that we use to heat our homes and to turn on our lights and to cook our food. The real prize is ethane, which is a liquid hydrocarbon that's released from the shale alongside the methane and other hydrocarbons to make plastic and other petrochemicals. So all of these wells that you see here, the orange dots in southwest Pennsylvania and Ohio and West Virginia, on both sides of the Ohio River, produce ethane, which will feed this massive ethane cracker plant being built by Shell just 24 miles down the Ohio River and upwind from downtown Pittsburgh. The cracker plant is one of the largest ever built anywhere in the world. Transform fracked ethane molecules into ethylene. Once the plant is completed and operational in the next, actually this year, it will produce millions of tons of these tiny plastic polyethylene nurdles, or plastic pellets, which are put in boxes and sent to plastics factories around the country and around the world. They're put on trucks and trains, on barges. margin is, and away they go. There are several more cracker plants that are scheduled to be built, making this area the country's newest petrochemical hub. And unfortunately, America's next cancer alley, right here in the upper Ohio River Valley. If everything goes according to the plan, the industry, this build-out is going to require 1,000 new frac gas wells to be drilled and fracked every year in this region. So if you just have to remember that it's all to create the one thing that nature doesn't need any more of, which is more plastic, especially single-use plastic. So again, in southwest Pennsylvania, we're fracking for methane, which is mostly for the global market. And remember that. It's not about energy independence or making your bills cheaper. It's suddenly, methane has suddenly become extremely profitable for the multinational oil and gas companies. And we're also fracking to make more plastic. So I think that you're familiar with a map like this or a graph like this that Ali showed. I'm not going to describe again what fracking is and what it isn't. The rig on the left is conventional, straight down drilling, and up comes the oil and gas. Fracking is the middle picture there. So they drill, they split the pipe down, they cement it in, they pump millions of gallons of fresh water. We're talking anywhere from these days, 10 to 20 million million gallons per well, per frack job, as well as sand to keep those cracks open. And then the chemicals that they use, and those chemicals are proprietary. The industry is not required by law to tell us what chemicals they're using, which puts physicians like me at a disadvantage when I'm trying to help my sick patients. But we have a general idea of the kind of chemicals they're using. What goes down is one thing, but what comes back is something else. The solid drill cuttings, the work, the rock, the dirt, the salty, corrosive brine, they return to the to the surface. The liquid flow back is very corrosive with that brine that contains natural elements like lead and arsenic. Those are heavy metals that are particularly dangerous to children. There are naturally occurring radioactive materials like radium-226, which has a half-life of 1,600 years, and radium-228, and other radioactive materials. You know, geologists have known for decades that the Marcellus Shale is highly radioactive. No one seems to talk about that. The evidence is in. They've known that, and the oil and gas companies have known that for decades. So much of the solid waste is dumped in commercial and municipal landfills, where it sits percolating, and then it leaches into the surrounding soil, surface waters, and groundwater. Liquid flowback is also taken by trucks and injected into deep underground injection wells. Most of those are out of state, but there are a few. There's one in Plum. Actually, that is recently built. The DEP is in the process of permitting another injection well, which is right next to the Ohio, right to the Allegheny River, and it's just upstream of where the city of Pittsburgh gets its drinking water. In addition, some of the toxic brine is marketed to municipalities and consumers as de-icing agents and pool salt. There are the non-fuel gases, the volatile organic compounds, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, and radon gas, which is a big problem in humans. It's the number two cause of lung cancer. And then you have the methane and the other liquid and hydrocarbons. In southwest Pennsylvania, we have a lot of wet gas, so there's a lot of liquid hydrocarbons like propane, butane, and as I mentioned, ethane. So the wellhead, this is really important because I think Ali's talk focused mostly on the well pad. But the wellhead isn't the only place where harmful pollution is generated. Contamination of the air and the water and the soil occurs. occurs at every point of frack gas infrastructure. Diesel emissions result from the thousands of heavy trucks needed to service each well, and then from the diesel engines that are on the well in order to generate pressure to crack open the shale, which is a mile under our feet, and then to be able to push all that water through those cracks to release the hydrocarbons. We also have to remember that a lot of these wells are super well pads. We saw one well in Ali's well pad in Ali's presentation that's permitted for 40 wells on one well pad, 40 wells. These are super well pads. Pipelines scar the landscape. They occasionally leak and spill, and they can corrode and explode. Pigging stations keep the pipelines free of sludge and scale by launching air toxics into the atmosphere. Compressor stations that push gas through pipelines emit huge volumes of air pollutants. Pollution continues in the processing facilities that separate and refine the hydrocarbons. And then beyond the local cracker plants, as I mentioned, and plastics factories and other petrochemical facilities. And finally, we should remember that a lot of the fracked gas is actually exported to other states and other countries. So really, you know, what happens here doesn't stay here for the most part, except when it's related to plastic. So fracking happens in Pennsylvania, where people live and children play. In this state, the minimum setback distance from a home or a child care center or a school or another building is 500 feet. That's right, 500 feet. The well pads and the pipelines and the compressor stations and the processing facilities are all operating around where kids go to school. This school campus in Washington County is surrounded by 5 well pads and other infrastructure. The closest well pad you see on the left is 900 feet from this school's driveway. That's 900 feet from the only entrance and exit of the school campus. And fracking is happening around where children play. I don't think any parent, and certainly no pediatrician, would look at this picture and say that it's acceptable in any way. Because they're growing and developing rapidly, children are more vulnerable to environmental toxins. This is what the fracking looks like in Pennsylvania, which is the second largest natural gas producing state in the nation. And we've got more than 13,000 active shale gas wells in the state, which you see is the purple dots on this updated frack tracker map. Most of the activity is in northeastern Pennsylvania and southwestern Pennsylvania, and almost all of it has happened in the last 10 to 12 years. The white triangles, I don't know if you can see them, but those are the several hundred compressor stations, and the yellow dots indicate where all the violations have occurred so far. There are some red dots in there that indicate where the wastewater injection wells are. We have more wastewater injection wells outside of the state than we do inside of Pennsylvania. You can see that there's a growing network of pipelines connecting Pennsylvania frack plants to power plants and export hubs. The Marcus Cook facility near Philadelphia is rapidly expanding to accept more frack gas as the liquefied natural gas, or LNG. In addition to all of these unconventional wells, by the way, there are hundreds of thousands of conventional oil and gas wells drilled in the last 150 years that you don't see on this map. It's estimated that at least 200,000 of these conventional old-fashioned wells have been abandoned and left uncapped. And these wells also leak VOCs and methane into the atmosphere, contributing to air pollution, climate change, and poor health for Pennsylvanians. The 8th edition of the Fracking Science Compendium contains evidence and lots of it. There are many studies and investigations that were conducted here in Pennsylvania that show correlations between living and working close to fracking operations and health damage. In communities where teeming diesel truck traffic flows, where the diesel engines operate, the diesel pollution is pretty significant for fracking operations. And all of the other sources of pollution adverse impacts on health and mental well-being. Now, public health research is not designed to find evidence beyond a reasonable doubt. Although there are several items contained in the compendium that we actually do know beyond a reasonable doubt. One thing we know is that there is no evidence, zero, that fracking can be practiced in a manner that does not directly threaten human health directly, or that does not imperil climate stability upon which human health depends. Again, there are no peer-reviewed studies, none, showing that fracking can be done safely, because it can't. Fracking is inherently dirty and dangerous, and industry rules and government regulations can't fix that basic fact. We know that fracking has never been done safely anywhere it's been done, and it can't be done safely here. Here's what else we know beyond a reasonable doubt. We know that fracking scars the landscape and degrades the environment that humans and all life forms depend on. You can see this from space. I think Ali showed Google Maps or Google Earth images. One of my favorite places to spend some time is on Google Earth, because you can really see it from space. We know beyond a reasonable doubt that fracking degrades the environment that humans and all life forms depend on. We know it pollutes the air, the water, and the soil that we all share. Beyond a reasonable doubt, we know that fracking endangers wildlife and aquatic creatures and farm animals and family pets, and it threatens ecological diversity wherever it operates. We know, again, like I mentioned, that it exacerbates plastic pollution, which in the last few decades has truly become a global ecological catastrophe. And it's only going to get worse when that cracker plant comes online later this year. We know that contrary to what the industry wants everybody to believe, we know that fracking accelerates climate change and threatens the future health and prosperity of our children and our grandchildren. And finally, we know beyond a reasonable doubt that fracking makes people sick. Water pollution is inevitable with fracking. There are numerous examples of drilling and fracking activities contaminating rivers, streams, and aquifers in Pennsylvania. That I showed with all the violations. A lot of that were violations for polluting surface waters and groundwater. And Pennsylvania fracking companies have been criminally charged and fined for illegally polluting surface water and groundwater. And we shouldn't ignore the fact that contamination and depletion of water supplies is a risk and typically impacts poor and rural communities the most. Because it's exempt from key provisions of the U.S. Safe Drinking Water Act, the oil and gas industry is allowed to keep these chemicals that they use secret, as I mentioned before. But still, we know that there are more than 1,000 chemicals that are used in fracking fluid, and about 100 of them are known endocrine disruptors that act as reproductive and developmental toxicants. And at least 48 of these chemicals that are used are potentially carcinogenic. They can cause cancer. Also, geologists and the oil and gas industry, as I said, have known for decades that the Marcellus Shale is highly radioactive. So, Physicians for Social Responsibility has published two studies recently showing that highly toxic per- and polyfluoroalkyl substances, you may know them as PFAS chemicals or forever chemicals, were used in thousands of oil and gas wells over the last decade. And the Philadelphia Inquirer conducted its own study last year in Pennsylvania, and they found that PFAS chemicals had been used during drilling and fracking activities here. Citing willful ignorance among Pennsylvania officials, the paper's editorial board ended their analysis by saying, "Our findings should raise concerns for all Pennsylvanians." So they were talking to Pennsylvanians like me as a doctor. They were talking to policymakers and law. lawmakers. They were talking to concerned residents like you. Well, doctors are concerned, and I can tell you that residents who I talk to are concerned. Lawmakers in Harrisburg, though, not so much. The EPA, incidentally, is worried about it. This was in today's Washington Post, where they're very concerned about PFAS chemicals, and they are changing the regulations surrounding them. There's overwhelming evidence contained in the compendium showing that drilling and fracking operations create a harmful air pollution at levels known to damage human health. Once again, communities of color, low-income communities, and rural communities are disproportionately impacted. As documented in more than 100 studies, toxic air pollution accompanies fracking. More than 200 airborne chemical contaminants have been detected near drilling and fracking sites. And air monitoring has confirmed strikingly high levels of air pollutants in communities near these sites. Of these, 61 are classified as hazardous air pollutants with known health risks, including the potent carcinogens, benzene, and formaldehyde. Another 26 are classified as endocrine-disrupting chemicals. So this is the type of activity that you can expect to contaminate your airship. So these are the common air toxics. If you saw some of them on a previous slide, the fine and ultra-fine particulate matter, PM2.5, cause heart and respiratory problems, cancer and chronic inflammatory diseases. Volatile or organic compounds can cause cancer and endocrine disease. Polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons cause endocrine disruption, immune dysfunction, and cancer, and really mess up fetal and early infant development. The fracking chemicals themselves can become aerosolized. It can be inhaled and cause illness and disease. Silica dust causes silicosis, chronic lung disease, and lung cancer. Heavy metals, lead, arsenic, and mercury are especially toxic to young children. Those teen worms, the naturally occurring radioactive materials, cancer, and they're so concerning in the fracking basin. Carbon monoxide, a lot of it is produced from all those diesel engines. It's toxic to every human. Nitrogen oxides are respiratory tract irritants, and they affect everyone's lung function. And finally, the greenhouse gases, CO2 and methane, which is leading us to climate. With the exception of silica dust, all of these air toxics that you see on this slide, they're all invisible, and they make people sick. As I mentioned earlier, even with the best intentions, regulations can't protect communities from harm because of fracking's inherent risks coming from air pollution, radioactive releases, earthquakes even, leaking wells, and intentional flaring and venting of air contaminants into the atmosphere. Fracking has a huge toxic and radioactive waste problem that clearly does not get enough attention in Western Pennsylvania. Solid waste and sludge contaminated with fracking chemicals, corrosive salts, heavy metals, and radiation are dumped into landfills, as I mentioned, and that leads to contamination of surface waters and groundwater and soil. Wastewater is trucked away. You've seen those brine trucks or residual waste trucks on our highways. They're carrying the wastewater to injection wells. And like I said, many of them are out of state, some of them are here in the state. The radioactive materials, they're brought to the surface and they're really causing a big problem with the solid and the liquid waste. So people who live near fracked gas operations report many different adverse health impacts. One study from Environmental Health Project lists the top 10 symptoms reported by people living within 1 kilometer, which is about 0.6 miles from the active shale gas well in Pennsylvania. Sleep disruption is often the result of effects and anxiety are side effects of living near fracking operations. There's coughing and wheezing. There was shortness of breath, sinus problems, fatigue and nausea. I've experienced many of these symptoms myself as I traveled around Washington County, where I live, to visit people or visit fracking sites. So I can tell you that these are real. Some of these symptoms look like nuisance complaints, but when people are exposed to fracking activity day in and day out, for months and even years at a time, these acute symptoms of exposure and stress often become chronic medical problems. Higher hospitalization rates for cancer, asthma, and heart problems have been documented in people living near unconventional oil and gas development. It's also linked to other health problems, some of which I mentioned earlier can start out small and turn into huge problems for people and their families living near. You don't have to be a scientist, you don't have to be a doctor like me to realize that fracking is injustice. Direct public health impacts from fracking pollution and impacts from methane emissions on climate change are not borne equally by Pennsylvanians. In this state and throughout the United States, pregnant women, children, indigenous people, communities of color, and low-income communities are disproportionately harmed by fracking. Studies, many of which were conducted here in Pennsylvania, now show that living near fracking sites can complicate pregnancies and lead to poor birth outcomes like prematurity, low birth weight, small for gestational age newborns.